I am suffering, but also at the same time enjoying this challenge very, very much. And I really want you to believe that I'm doing it for the right reasons. I care about Mother Earth. I care about the world we're leaving for you. Most of all, I care about you and your happiness and your well-being. Hopefully, I'll make it to the top. And from here to there, I'll be praying non-stop for the things that are valuable to us all and to the things that we care about. And being alone here really allows someone to think about the issues in life, the world. For me, it's a meditative experience.
I can actually see in many of your eyes that you think I'm crazy for climbing Mount Everest. Well, I can comfortably say you're not alone. Having done it, I think I'm crazy too. This year was one of the most tragic years, unfortunately, on Everest. You may question why on earth a business leader, someone who runs one of the largest appliance businesses in the world, or a father of three young children would ever attempt something so dangerous. The answer is actually quite straightforward. At Arçelik, we've been climbing mountains for a long time to raise awareness on climate change. What you call climate change today, I call climate catastrophe, because I don't think you can change the planet we're in like you can change a pair of jackets or shirts. We started this journey in 2011 by climbing Kilimanjaro, the highest mountain in Africa. We continued with Elbrus, the highest mountain in Europe, and after that, Aconcagua, the highest mountain in Americas last year, and finally Everest this May. You may say, why Everest? Because Everest actually draws the best and the worst out of people, because it is a magical word that everybody pays attention. If I were here speaking to you about sustainability alone, you would probably start yawning in 2 minutes. Whereas when I spice it with Everest and I actually show you the risks that I have taken to raise awareness, you pay much more attention. It's almost guaranteed. The film we prepared, a version of which you just saw, got viewed 14 million times. So I call that actually successful in raising awareness towards climate change. You may think, why did we choose the Himalayas as a region? Well, actually, one of the most immediate and direct impacts of global warming is the melting glaciers. In the past 50 years, we have lost roughly 1/3 of the glaciers that populate the Khumbu region and the greater Himalayas. If we don't do something drastic and quick, we will lose the remaining 2/3 in the next 80 years. What does this mean? It's not just simply losing ice. This means that the water source that 2 billion people depend on for irrigation, for growing food, for drinking water, will disappear. When the water disappears, these people will have to move, and when they move, they will move onto other people's land. This is immigration on a scale humanity has never seen. And there's no solution to this. You can't create enough energy. There is no sea to desalinate water. Once the glaciers are gone, these people will have to move. This is really drastic and urgent. Rapid and substantial action has to be taken actually now. I want to take you somewhere else actually. Since childhood, I personally have been a big fan of the sea. I'm in awe of the sea, sea creatures, life, and the beauty it brings with it. Every chance I got, I found myself at the sea, either sailing or enjoying the waters. I also was fortunate enough to live in Hong Kong for 13 years, and it meant Thailand was within proximity to sail or travel to. And Maya Bay actually is one of the most beautiful places on Earth. The steep cliffs, the beautiful vegetation, the incredible corals, sand beaches, clear, crisp water, marine life, unparalleled. I kid you not, one of the most beautiful places in the world. Well, after being there many, many years, I have very young children. I thought I would take them there and show them this beautiful spot. And I actually created stories where I told them there would be pirates who actually hid treasures in caves on this beach, and we would go by boat, we would walk through, go into the cave, find the treasures. I excited them tremendously for weeks and weeks on end. Well, guess what happened? I took my children there, and it was an absolute disaster. I had to carry them literally through knee-deep layers of plastic. I couldn't even put them on the ground. And make no mistake, this is not just happening in Maya Bay. This is happening everywhere. This is not something that has been happening for 20 years. This is something that is very recent. This is happening because most developing countries are growing at a pace which is causing them to consume single-use plastics much, much more than has been in the past. And this is resulting in scenes like this repeating itself everywhere. It's depressing. I don't like showing this picture. We can actually choose to be depressed about it, or we can choose to do something about it. Finding a purpose is the most important key point in doing something about this. As one of Europe's leading manufacturers of appliances, we have decided to do something about this. Our products reach millions of homes in more than 146 countries around the world. We devote ourselves to a vision which actually respects the environment. Respects the world, respected worldwide. This is our vision statement. We go to bed with this, we wake up with this, we work with this, we live it, we breathe it. Every action we take is devoted to making this vision come to a reality. Sustainability in the past used to be seen as a nice to have. People would put it in their annual reports, have a few sentences on their websites. Today, sustainability is a way of life. It is a business model. It is a way that, as responsible leaders and businesses, we have to change our act and fall into line with. If you actually take a purpose as an individual, as a business leader, and come to work every day with that purpose, you will see it trickling down to the employees, to the suppliers, business partners, everybody in the ecosystem that you actually work with. More importantly than that, though, I think now the world has finally woken up and awareness on this topic has grown beyond the ecosystem of our industry. I believe today customers are actually willing to pay more for sustainable products. A global survey of 30,000 people, and 30,000 people is a very large sample size, showed that 62% of these people would prefer a brand or a product, even if it's more expensive, that does the right thing by the planet. This is not a trend that is temporary. This is a trend to stay and will grow. Companies that differentiate with sustainable products that do the right thing by the world, that do the right thing by the environment, will get chosen over and again every time. The way to win in the long term is to do the right thing. How do we do the right thing? Well, as leaders, our responsibility is great. We have to actually stand up and create positive change. By creating this positive change, I also believe that we are doing the right thing for shareholders. I already mentioned that consumers are willing to choose brands that do the right thing. I also argue, and I have proven many times, that actually taking the sustainability road and doing the right thing will result in higher profits. Many of the initiatives we've taken at Arçelik has resulted in reduced costs or improved profitability and pricing for our products, which actually translates to good business. We focus on the most important global issues, and we focus all of our innovation and R&D strength in these areas. I also mentioned, I'll go back to Maya Bay. Plastic pollution is one of the biggest problems of our world today. In every single minute, more than 2 million plastic bags, 1 million water bottles or drink bottles are consumed. More than 90% of these are not recycled. This video you're watching on the screen is actually taken in Bali. When you think of Bali, you think of beautiful beaches, water, marine life, turtles, mantas. Well, guess what? If you go diving in Bali, in many places you will see this scene. This is the direct cause of countries, developing countries, that are actually consuming more and more single-use plastic. More than 8 million tons of plastic find its way into the oceans every single year. And this has gotten to this degree in the past couple of years. If we don't stop this, In 2 years, 3 years' time, this is going to be 15 million tons, 20 million tons, 25 million tons. If this is what it looks like today, do you want to show your children what it looks like in 10 years' time? We have to do something about this. This is not only also visual pollution. We work with a lot of researchers in universities, and they have been actually testing fish samples, marine life samples from all over the world. And when I say all over the world, I mean from the Arctic to the Mediterranean to the Pacific to the Red Sea. In each and every single sample of seafood, or actually marine life that they have tested, they have found the presence of microplastics and microfibers. This is a topic which I will touch on later on in my speech. What is very clear is we have to rethink our relationship and how we use plastics. We have to rethink our relationship to plastics and the waste that it creates. Why don't we take the waste plastic and make appliances? Why don't we challenge the way we actually make new appliances? Well, I'll get to that when I start talking about the products. But for now, let's park the plastic issue aside and let's focus a little bit on energy. Creating energy also creates a lot of pollution. So we, as an industry, appliance industry, have a responsibility to reduce the amount of energy our appliances use, reduce the amount of energy requirements we put on the grid and on governments to invest in coal-fired power plants. I want to use an example of South Africa. As you know, when I was introduced, DeFi was introduced as one of our brands. South Africa, we're very proud, more than 40% market share in sub-Saharan Africa. But as you know, South Africa has been challenged with rolling power cutouts for a very, very long time, and they have been unable to invest in new power generation capacity. So when we bought this business in South Africa in 2011, the average energy level rating of the refrigerator was E. We voluntarily, without regulation, took the decision to actually only sell A energy level refrigerators, which would be in line with today's energy regulations in the EU. This voluntary action actually resulted in higher market share in the cooling business. It resulted in 50% less energy consumption in the market. So ultimately, this is good for the consumer. They're paying less for electricity. It's good for us. We've gained market share by doing the right thing. It's good for the government of South Africa because they had to invest in three power plants less, coal-fired 500 megawatt power plants. You can imagine how much pollution that creates. And obviously, it's very good for the environment. We are always looking for win-wins in situations like this. What can we do to change which will actually be beneficial to every stakeholder? Now, what we are taking is this example that we had in South Africa, in sub-Saharan Africa, to other markets, in Pakistan with Dolans, in Bangladesh with Singer. These are also markets where we are dominating the household appliance businesses. And these are also markets where energy is a challenge. 70% of the people live off the grid. India is another example where we will have some solutions coming as well. Now, this is a win-win for everyone. How are we making this happen? It's actually quite simple. Arçelik has been investing in R&D for 25 years. We have more than 1,500 R&D professional engineers, many of them with PhDs. We have been consistently among the top 100 companies that is actually graded by the World Intellectual Property Organization in terms of patent applications. This last year, we were number 67 in the world. Innovation and IP doesn't come on itself. It comes with focused R&D activity and the right tools, the right approach to it. A good example, Garage, is a new generation R&D facility. It's a fast prototyping facility. This is where not just us, but outside startups are allowed to come in, share their ideas, go through ideation phase, and actually turn their ideas into prototypes from 18 different materials using very high-end printers, 3D printers, and then those ideas and products get tested in the market very, very fast. For innovation to be successful, it has to be quick, the results have to be visible, and the positive results and the failures have to be celebrated together. Of course, we have 17 different R&D facilities around the world because regional differences also play a key in developing product and innovating product that actually is good for the planet as well. Innovation and R&D itself is never enough. We have also been working on our production technologies. Our new facility in Romania, arguably, is the most innovative and most advanced production facility in our industry. I'm not the only one to say this. The World Economic Forum has selected this plant as one of 26 factories around the world, which is a lighthouse factory, to be an example to all industry with its automation levels, its efficiency levels, but most importantly, its use of data. This facility uses more data than I can even comprehend. It takes data points from 22,000 different points of creating data and makes sure it is using algorithms and artificial intelligence to continually upgrade its own manufacturing systems, its own planning processes, and actually it ends up with delivering technology to consumers at a better value, at a better quality, in a more efficient way. Why did we invest so much in one factory? Because we wanted to test every manufacturing technology out there, create an archaic way of doing things, and then quickly roll this out to our 23 factories in 9 countries around the world. This is actually reshaping the future. How are we putting these technologies, all of this R&D, innovation, production technology, into good use? Well, I'd like to focus actually on a few of the products that we've been working on. One of them is the solar fridge. Solar fridges have been around for a very, very long time. I mean, I'm sure you've seen them, you've heard about them, but what you haven't known is that they cost more than, in many cases, thousands of dollars because they require batteries, they require inverters, and of course the solar panel installation itself and the refrigerator itself. Well, we have taken this now and we have actually removed the need for the battery, removed the need for the inverter, and actually this product is now only a couple of hundred dollars. What does this mean? This actually puts this refrigerator in very remote communities' affordability level. It means that the 70% of sub-Saharan Africa that lives away from the grid or with patchy power grids will be able to afford a fridge which will give them food security. Almost more important than that, they will be able to preserve their vaccines, medications. This is life-changing. Again, this is good for every stakeholder. It's good for the communities that can afford this, that can use this. It's good for us. It opens up a completely new market, which normally we wouldn't be able to sell an appliance to. It's good for the governments. And guess what? Best of all, it's good for Mother Earth, because this is a radically different way of actually preserving power. It's a game changer. Now, of course, our commitment to sustainability goes far beyond energy efficiency. Another product that we've been working on, this is something also that I'm very excited by. It's early days, it's expensive, but it's a pioneer. We have made a refrigerator which is made 80% of bioplastics and 20% of food waste, things like eggshells, corn husk, things that are normally discarded. Why is this important? Because our landfills are being filled with plastics that don't get recycled and reused. If we can rethink the way we use plastic, and we can actually repurpose the plastic we use to biodegradable plastics. I imagine burying my fridge in my front yard and then there being no fridge there in 5 years' time. This is what I imagine. I'm not saying we're there yet, but we're getting there. And this is the world's first prototype, which will soon be in mass production. I know it's expensive. So were solar panels. 10, 15 years ago, one solar panel would cost you more than your car. Today, you can affordably put it in there and it pays back in a couple of years. I argue that once we're mass producing this fridge and it's widely adopted, we will actually get it to a price point which will be affordable for most. I think this is a general direction we all have to go, because the use of plastics is going to change drastically and regulation is going to limit the amount of plastics that we can use that is new. Now, that's an example of how we can repurpose using new plastics. But how about the waste that we've already created? Those PET bottles, those water bottles I showed you on Maya Beach, or the ghost fishing nets that are roaming the world. More than 650,000 tons of fishing nets are roaming the world, and that's every year. It's a lot of fishing nets, and it's a lot of plastic we're putting in the ocean. Well, we have come up with a washing machine that actually uses recycled plastic water bottles in its tub. We have used 25 million bottles up to date. This number is increasing every day. And you may think, okay, it's not a great deal. What difference does it make? Well, I argue 25, that's 25 million bottles less that's in a landfill or in the seas. And it makes a difference. And we actually tested some consumers. We saw when the consumers are given the choice between 10 different brands of washing machines in similar price ranges, similar specs, they always go for the one that has recycled plastics and bottles in there if it's communicated right. This is a way for a company, a product to differentiate. This is again a way to do the right thing. We haven't only done this, by the way, with PET water bottles. We've also started using ghost fishing nets in our products. Last year, we used 65 tons. And actually, it turns out that you can make thermal plastics, thermal nylon with fishing net waste, wasted fishing nets, recovered fishing nets, which has got great thermal properties and is perfect for using in our ovens. And again, we communicate this to the consumers. The consumers respond positively. So where people see plastic waste, something to throw away, we see value. We see something that can be used and a differentiation that can be made. Something very dear to my heart. This product, I believe, is the best innovation to come out of Arçelik to date. Today, we are approximately 300-400 people in this room. 60% of us are wearing clothes made from synthetic fibers. You've all heard of fast fashion. Fast fashion brings the cost down of clothes. They use more synthetic textiles, which are made from synthetic nylon yarns, which is made from petrol. When you think of ocean or plastic, microplastics in the oceans, you all imagine water bottle caps, lighter parts, toys, pen parts. What you don't imagine is these microfibers that I mentioned earlier that are smaller than 1 millimeter. These are everywhere. And actually, they come from your clothes. Overwhelmingly, they come from your clothes. Each and every single wash in by your washing machine releases more than 1 million of these microfibers into the oceans. And what's unfortunate is that governments or municipalities don't have filtration technologies that can actually capture these microfibers. They all end up in the oceans. What ends up in the oceans ends up in the stomach of fish, which ends up in your stomach, in our food chain. We are making ourselves sick. Now, as an industry, if we can do something about this, we have to do something about this. We have a short movie for you to watch.
Did you know that every meal you eat may contain more than 100 pieces of plastic? Microplastics now form approximately 60% of the materials that make up our clothes worldwide. When they're washed, they release tiny particles of plastics. These can remain in oceans and water resources for hundreds of years and find their way into our food chain. That's why we have created the world's first and only washing machine with a built-in synthetic microfiber filtration system. This revolutionary technology filters more than 90% of microfibers leaking in the water sources. This system will reshape the future of the water resources, wildlife, and most importantly, our food chain. Respecting the world, respected worldwide.
Many in our industry have told me that this is not our problem. This is the problem of the yarn manufacturer. This is the problem of the fabric manufacturer. This is the problem of fast fashion. Anybody but us. But guess what? If we are in a position to do something about it, we have to do something about it. Does it add cost? It does. Does it complicate the relationship with the customer? It does. But I believe that each customer faced with a choice of choosing a washing machine that will actually stop those microfibers from going into the oceans and hence their stomachs will choose a machine that can do this. I think another point that's very important here is that these filters themselves will be recycled. These filters are unwashable. They will be collected, recycled into new filters. This is why I say very comfortably that this is one of the most important innovations to come out of Arçelik to date. A lot of investment in R&D has gone into this, but we are prepared to share this technology with anyone who is interested in using it. I invite and challenge our competition, which is here today, to use this innovation in any way they wish. We are keen to work with any stakeholders, universities, NGOs, to actually further this technology. All we want to do is to make this technology widely used and adopted to prevent as many of these microfibers and plastics going into the ocean as quickly as possible. We must stop polluting the oceans now. It is actually time to take responsibility, to see the effects of our actions, and do what is right for the greater good. There's no more time for procrastination, indecisiveness. We need to act. One of my favorite sayings is by Einstein, "The world will not be destroyed by those who do evil, but by those who stand by and watch doing nothing." Change begins today, right here. Thank you for listening to me.
Just 'cause you're under, don't mean I'm wrong. Another.